much. Is the sound level okay?
Yes.
Good. The title is somewhat difficult, maybe. Technology as a driver of swimming success, because technology, for me, in my mind, technology is one aspect to improve our knowledge and understanding and formulating questions and problems. But I will try to share some of my experiences and some knowledge maybe of how, and I will use technology, how it's used in the Japanese system. I'm from Sweden. I moved to Japan in 2013. This is mostly my daily activity. This is in Flagstaff with Rie Canetto. I use a lot of video imaging to be able to reinforce movement changes and different movement patterns to improve performance. And in Japan, to my mind, what I see, imaging is a very strong thing. A lot of coaches and swimmers are very, very well, feeling very well with a lot of video analysis and video feedback. I worked previously with the Swedish Olympic Committee, supporting the Olympic swimmers. And the tasks were testing and feedback, research development, performance intelligence, and setting up projects for development. Currently in Japan, Japan Sports Council is my employer, and I work in and with the Japanese Olympic team and with head coach Nori Masahirai. The aim of my work is to give advice to swimmers and coaches on how to improve performance from an outside perspective. That was my invitation to come to Japan, the invitation from Norimasa and technical director Koji Ueno. So I work in an organization that is called JSC High Performance Support. It's a multifaceted organization, many aspects, medical, physiotherapy, biomechanists, many different aspects supporting high performance sports in Japan. This is my impression of Japan. Japan is very highly technological driven. To the left, you see the new maglev Shinkansen bullet train, and the sinkhole down at the right in Fukuoka 2 weeks ago was repaired within 1 week. And it was about 15 meters deep. And the picture on the right shows the sinkhole disappeared. And very efficient. You can make watermelons into cubes because it's more efficient to package them. Japan swimming numbers, there are between 5,500 and 6,000 clubs. There are 70,000 registered girls and about 50,000 boys. The Junior Olympic Cup for young swimmers, 10 and under, up to, there's an age group, an open age group too. One short course meet in March, one in long course in September. They both carry about 3,000 participants. The competition cycle, and this is maybe important for knowledge, background knowledge. The fiscal year in Japan starts April 1st, not January 1st. So you shift levels, school levels, on April 1. And the first competition in the new budget year is the Japan National Open Championships, which most of the times are trials for international competition. May, June, Japan Open, which is an open international competition. You are all welcome to come and take part, and it's it is a high level competition. August sees high school championships, junior high school championships. September into college. Last year, 1,573 participants. Only university students. And there's a Kokutai, like a regional championship in September between different prefectures. And you compete for your home prefecture. If you're from Fukuoka, you compete for Fukuoka, even if you live in Tokyo. So it goes back to the roots. October sees the World Cup short course meters, and March, the end short course Junior Olympic Cup. Team Japan performance at the Olympics in Rio was a success. Two gold medalists, two silver medals, very close to a gold in the 200 butterfly, three bronze medals, fourth in the medal count, and split third in the championships trophy. So the level of swimming is high. A centerpiece for transferring scientific knowledge to the training situation, to the coaches and swimmers, and to give support to the leading top-level swimmers, from young to the grown-ups, is JISS and NTC, the National Training Center, and JISS, Japan Institute of Sports Sciences. This is JISS, this is like a research building. Bottom floor sees the 50 meter pool and a specialized synchronized swimming pool, only for synchronized swimming. And then there are clinics, medical clinics, there are physiological testing facilities. There's actually a flume for rowing. This is the NTC with big judo pitches and handball and team sports. And across here is a, this has some accommodation and restaurants. And this one is the NTC, the big accommodation, the athletes' village. And it can, how many total beds? I mean, 300 people can be accommodated at one time. There is a high performance gym with whatever you need, and there are specialized cryotherapy, video feedback systems for lifting and balance and jumping. Highly technical. So here are force plates plus cameras that feedback your motion instantly. JIS and JSC supports the federations with requests on how to improve performance, how to improve the program, the training program, or the individual tracking of the athletes. Race analysis, Dr. Matsuda and Dr. Iwahara are here in the field. They go for race analysis in competitions outside of Japan a lot. Others do too. So there's always a team for race analysis from JIS, JSC, almost always. There's a Kistler-based start system, not the full Kistler system, but Kistler starting block plus the internal video system, Dr. Kubo, Dr. Matsuda. IT department service all sports with video support and cameras, computers support, database support. Smart system is a common system for all sports to upload video into a database. Judo, synchronized swimming, swimming, upload from competitions all over the world. So there's a huge database of, in principle, all Japanese athletes' performances. It started being used a lot with judo and synchronized swimming. They were pioneers in using the system. Super Sport Echo is a repeat recording system. I have a picture of it. iCool, high performance gym, a big gym with personal support for the athletes and the coaches, clinic and dentistry, MRI facilities, physio and rehab gym. So it's fairly complete in the support to the athletes and coaches that reach a certain qualification level. GISPool, this is the base for my, where I work most of the time. To the GISPool and to GIS and NTC, you can come if you have a certain qualification level. Then you can order to come for a stay, and you can take part in all the support activities. There are underwater cameras. This is actually from the synchronized swimming pool, but there are underwater cameras that are PTC cameras, pan, tilt, zoom. This is how we use the camera systems many times, to record live performances, like this is 50 meter freestyle time trial. So it's used for recording while the training is going on in the middle of in regular training. And you can set the camera system to, you can have 16 camera views at the same time, or you can set it up in fours or twos. Yeah, you can split the picture image. So if you combine it, you can get some pretty good overview of different, and it's possible to measure, put a measure system into it too. Most of the times, I support by getting the video and giving subjective slash objective comments on certain movements that we have decided on. Camera system, we use a capture unit to capture the video. And we can use different settings and capture from different views. So it's very, very simple. This is a messy video showing a little bit of the technical setup, the everyday setup. And this is something I realized for the last 3 years, 2 years. There is a lot of, this is a double tape. I have a camera here, a GoPro. Most of the time, many times I use a GoPro. And the coach has an iPhone or a smartphone that can manage to do many things these days. So if you combine it, the information, you get a fairly good coverage. What the decisions are, that is completely up to the coach and the swimmer and the level and the decision coach and swimmer has agreed upon, which is the development track, which way do you want to go. We have monitors, 4K and HD monitors that can show separate views. And this system is not so new, it's quite old in technical terms, but it's a turnkey system. It can be switched on. We can actually do it in maybe 3-4 minutes. Yeah, and that's Japanese style, I think. the starting point for young swimmers in Japan to meet this type of technology analysis. I call it technology-based diagnosis and learning. It could be also called maybe evidence-based to some degree, a little bit, because you get some objective information data. It may be a video, it may be some measurement. In April, after the short course Junior Olympic Cup, there's an elementary school camp. I think 10 and under is the first one. And that's the best, maybe 20 kids in Japan that are the best ones from the Junior Olympic Cup. And there's another one based from the long course championships in August. So they come to JIS, and their parents are invited, and JASF scientific committee do testing, video capture, testing, analyzing swimming technique, and giving feedback and education, teaching. Nutritionists talk with swimmers and parents about good nutrition. And so this is a capture of one of these swims. And all the swimmers are analyzed. Individual data and group data. So the swimmers are actually monitored every year. The next group of elementary school kids, young kids, are monitored every year for the level of different parameters. And this is done by the JASF Scientific Committee. They travel to training camps and they go to competitions. It's pretty slow, so it takes about 40 seconds more. So the swimmers get acquainted with race analysis, segmental timing, stroke counts, stroke lengths, and the coaches and the parents too. So the concepts are introduced. These are the contents, some important contents. Evaluation, measurement, investigation. There's a big focus on injury prevention and taking care. Self-care and observing from the coaches, observing to avoid injury or overuse injuries. For the young kids, there's what they see is some shoulder, not so much, but some shoulder sensitivity. So doctor, injury survey, body function measurement, abdominal pressure measurement is critical because there is a tendency to low back pain problems in Japan. The senior swimmers used to have quite a bit of low back pain problems. Care, icing guidance, exercise stretching guidance, measurement feedback from the swim, nutrition workshops for parents. So this is the concept. There's an Olympian participating to give the direct connection to see a real Olympian. Staff of the swimming federation, analyst, nutritionist, physiotherapist, doctor, head coach for the camp. I think this is a good example of how essential technology is. With MRI, and easily accessible an MRI, it is possible to detect if low back pain has a physical source, if there is any disc hernia or sliding discs or vertebra. This is what it used to be like in the senior group. About 51% complained about, not complained, but noted low back pain. And this last Olympics, it's actually significantly lower. So that's a very strong program in Japan to acquire the capacity, the knowledge to do warm-up, stretching, and core programs for core strength. This continues with national camps. There are block camps for all the prefectures or like counties. National junior camp in December, one for boys and one for girls, where the scientific community comes and do the measurements again. This is a qualification time. And these could be between 12 and 18 in age. And there has been British junior swimmers attending and French junior swimmers the last 3-4 years. About 70 plus 70, 140 total. Race analysis. Japan has a race analysis project in the JASF Scientific Committee. And this is a really elaborated system where the swimmers can pick up their own race video plus the data on their smartphone. And this is done, the race analysis is done for all swimmers, heats and final and semifinal, all swimmers in the national championships, not only finals, everybody. So they can personally pick up their information and track it, or get it on the internet, but this is a very smooth and easy way. The race analysis setup is roughly like this. There are two wide cameras and then there are sweeping cameras. So you have a wide view, two wide views, and then individual cameras covering every two lanes. So that's how you can cover all the swimmers in all the heats. This is what the setup looks like in Tatsumi. So it's a substantial group, and they are very busy, and they work very hard, and they produce a lot, but they're still happy. So from the race analysis data, from the database, you can pick up all races historically and compare, and you can select for different parts of the race, first 15 or turn, to have a very quick measure. And in the database using a computer, so you can pick up information real quick. Also, during competition, there is underwater video. Almost all competitions on the national championship level. Sometimes NHK is doing the broadcast, K camera. That's what you saw, the high resolution, high quality camera. But the GIS staff and JSC staff is always doing two cameras for the underwater. Some other special technologies are also used. And they're like border science and applied science. Measurement of maximal oxygen uptake, the MAD system, Dutch system from the 1980s, developed in the 80s, is used for estimation of active drag. And this is a very significant drive in some parts of Japan. Short interval training, sprint interval training, and high intensity interval training done in a flume or in the pool. Based on the Ogita swimming protocol, it's emanating from Tabata protocol, I think. That's right, Yasuo? From the out of the Tabata protocol. 5 seconds max work, 10 seconds rest, 5 cycles. The test protocol here is 5 to 7, 5 second, 10, 2 times. 7 to 10, 20 plus 10. There are maybe more, but there are big flumes. Big meaning they are working with a good water flow, not so turbulent. They can keep a laminar flow and quite clear, at least in 4 universities. There are maybe some more, but these are the research universities. And out of these swimming flumes, this is in Kanoya. Kanoya swimming flume is a pressure chamber. So the whole flume is in a like the USOC one was in a pressure chamber once. Now it's gone. So this is a maximum oxygen uptake test and measurement. They use the Douglas bag method. And this incremental step test, 1 minute increments. And here they're using, this is a Swiss system for heart rate monitoring and time, named Freelab. And it's working very well. I used in Sweden a long time ago a Swiss system named Baumann Haldi, which may be a predecessor to the Freelab one. So it's 1 minute steps until exhaustion. And this is around 1.78 maybe meters per second. And the water flow is still very good. This is the sprint protocol. There are quite a few programs using variants of the sprint protocols in the pool. You can use cords, resistive cords. You can use separate kicking.
Yeah.
quite noisy though, but the flume has many good aspects. That's failure. This is the heart rate monitoring from the Freelab in the test the guy did. So the short interval goes up to about 150. And in this case, this is not max, but it's fairly high for even a short, very short repetition. Yeah, this is a Freelab system. And it's functional, it's functional. This is a international level sprinter doing the same type of exercise. It's even more noisy. Personally, I think the flume setup is interesting for technical feedback. You may not be able to get a good underwater. This is in field. These guys are. This is Ipe Watanabe. I think he's ranked number one in the world in the 200 breaststroke from last year. Made the final, he didn't medal, but he was improved quite a lot. Still very clear. This is Masato Sakai, he was number silver medalist in the 200 butterfly. He lost by 4 500s. No, he won a silver medal. And this is another exercise.
You have lecture today. What is it?
The Ogita protocol has been shown to improve not only anaerobic sprint capacities, but carries over to aerobic endurance, sprinting capability, like sprint endurance. Coach Okuno is the coach for these two guys and the sprint board.
But next time, let's coordinate it, because we can't, otherwise we'll never meet.
Yes.
Okay. Now, Asan...
So what they do is, in the free pool, either sprint or do resisted cords. 5 seconds, 10 seconds, five ten.
So let's look at what they have got first.
Yes.
And then the rest we can consolidate here.
Do you want to present?
This is another other type of equipment for towing. There are some use of the towing equipment. This is an Italian AP lab used in Norway. Johan is using it in Norway. It's used in Bergen, I think. And that's a way to make it possible to get controlled over speed or controlled resistive speed. Yasuo, Dr. Sengoku, you says, introduce. In scuba, they use a intensity scale or ranking system that is a little bit different. It's a bit different, has another approach than maybe based on lactates or heart rates that we are used to from history. Power is the critical, is the grading, the power of the effort. Active drag measurement is done on the MAD system, which is measures the pressure the swimmer produces on the pads and calculates the efficiency and the power output. And that's another, there's another method that can be used to estimate active drag. And it's the active drag could be an interesting measure in some cases, I think. Technology. This is the first time I saw this one in action on poolside. But there are the Tritonware and others that have like in principle the same functionality. Accelerometers, and in Japan they are producing very, very small waterproof, completely waterproof. That, and I think the next step is being able to transmit from underwater. It's pretty close, pretty near. Many coaches use iPhones or phones, smartphones. And there are several apps that can help you compare, take time. I think there even is a timing, really precise timing app that you can use for 15. This guy is a breaststroker. He's competing in this competition. So he's doing two different starts, and the coach helps him compare the time and the efficiency of the two jumps. A special case in Japan is NHK, the National Broadcasting Company. They have a technical division that tried to develop new ways of capturing and broadcasting. At the moment, NHK went to Rio and tried 8K broadcasting, taping broadcast in 8K. I went to a place in Tokyo in October, and they displayed on an 8K display what they filmed in Rio, and 8K is better than 4K. High resolution. I'm a sucker for resolution, so it is much better. But this is a special machine. This is it's developed for synchronized swimming. So there are two cameras, and there's an algorithm for getting the two views underwater and above to melt together, merge together to be realistic. We got the possibility to use this one in the GIS pool, and it can give you some information. It can give you some information that you may not get from a fixed above and under. But this is sophisticated. You can see you can get a better appreciation of how the movement is in the boundary between air and water. There is a Spanish product actually that based on this one that can be used for training purposes. Motion capture is done on the elite team, on the top team in Japan, using Qualisys by Dr. Matsuda and Dr. Kubo et al., a big group. They use Qualisys is a Swedish motion capture system that functions underwater. You put marker on the subject and this is the outcome, one outcome. So this is the speed. So left arm is gliding here. This may be quite common in Japan, overgliding and losing the pressure on the left arm. Here. So if you can match this with real high-speed video now. But indeed, looking at the details, there are many of the top swimmers that actually find things in their motion when they get rid of the body and only have the points. The stick figure can give you another appreciation of what's happening. This is Rie Canetto. And this package is pretty strong, and she has a very, very strong kick. Her start is not so good, but she has a strong, very strong kick. So this is what I do many times. I try to capture underwater video, even competition, if possible. When the swimmer is fresh and the coach is fresh and it's preparing for the near the time for the peak performance. This is, I think, before the final. Yeah, I think it is for the 200. And I use a simple GoPro and try to transfer some images for the coach and swimmer to evaluate. It's a little hard, you can't start it. I'm sorry. Soon, very soon. So Rhea and her coach, and many—I would say many of the coaches, almost all the coaches that I meet in Japan, they work a lot. This was a focus point: hip rotation, pelvic rotation, to get the pressure, keep the pressure. This is another method. Johan, courtesy Johan, Norway again, Sweden, Norway. Doppler device for the intracyclic speed. I think it has some think you can get, analyzing the speed, left, right side, or the speed cycle breathing, that can give you, the swimmer, a good, some good points. So there are devices, there are technology. What are the main research areas in Japan? According to the experts and what I read, biomechanics and hydrodynamics are two fields that are really focused on for quite a long time. And the Tabata protocol and the high intensity repetition training is something I think will develop even more, go in depth. And this is Yasuo Sengoku, Dr. Sengoku, and he's one of the chairmen for the BMS in swimming, 2018 at Tsukuba. September is a beautiful time in Tokyo, around Tokyo and Japan, so, and I think Nori is key lecturer, maybe. Maybe, tabu. So please visit the Tsukuba. Dr. Sengoku, this is a type of high intensity repetition kicking. Right? Yeah. So doing it set against the wall with the high intensity repetitions. There are some newer facilities. Japan has a, it's quite, I come from Sweden, we don't have, there is no pool that is only for swimming. I don't think so. Maybe the military or the navy has one, but it's not for competition swimming. But there are many, many, many full-size pools. We came from a pre-camp in Hamamatsu. 3 meter deep all over. The floor is adjustable to 0 and 3 meters, and it works. There are many adjustable floors around the world, but most of them don't work. But this is one of the newest facilities, and it's focused on, has focused also on video setup. So this pool has 36 cameras under, above, on the sides. So you can capture almost everything, and the video system is made by Panasonic. Panasonic is a main sponsor to the NTC JSC. So, if I have a problem with our system, or somebody have a problem with our video system, we call the guys that from Panasonic that live in this. So they're stationed in JIS. There's a team stationed to service all the Panasonic stuff. So this is a new Panasonic system run from a Toughpad. And the cameras are, they have a tracking function too. So we'll see. Another block, another key area in Japan and Japanese swimming is altitude training. I have promoted altitude training in Sweden and support and used it. And in Japan it's even more focus on altitude training in the training puzzle. Natural sites for the Rio preparation, Flagstaff, Sierra Nevada, Mexico City. Other times, also Font-Romeu, Mexico, Kunming. I think those are the places. There is no place in Japan yet. There may be one, but there's not yet. At JIS, they have altitude rooms. So So you can stay. They have maybe they can house 30 people, I think, and maybe as high as 3,500. So they are hyperbaric. And some coaches and swimmers use it in preparation for the natural altitude, about 1 week before travel. And they set it a little higher to evaluate the reaction, and they may back down if SpO2 goes too low. There are many universities, not many, but there are universities that have altitude chambers for exercise work. Flumes and altitude simulation. Kanoya flume is in the chamber, so that you can pressurize the whole chamber and swim. But there are canopies in these three, so you can make a hypoxic environment for training. Oh, sorry, wrong way. Just to give you an idea, 17 out of 34 swimmers used altitude in the final preparation for Rio, like the last 3 months. And they returned to sea level between 10 and 19 days. That's an individual personal choice. Maybe less than 10. And this means different layouts, different length. Total length around 30, 35 days. This guy went to altitude. And Rio went to altitude too. Supporting technologies to support the altitude training with data information on how to balance training, when to overload, when to offload. Hemoglobin estimation, SpO2, lactate pro, full blood work many times. Full blood work is in the Japanese coach's plan. This is how technology is used. Some use mild hyperbaric oxygen therapy and ice baths for recovery, enhanced recovery. Probably depends mostly on availability. Mild hyperbaric oxygen. Ice bath. This is used in combination with others, but this is used fairly commonly in the body. It's a bioimpedance. And in the case of two of the swimmers, male swimmers, at the highest level, there's been a clear goal to gain muscle mass and keep the muscle mass and also the body weight during travel, after competition, heavy competition, to stay in the upper ranges of muscle mass. So these types of instruments are used to verify in which direction. And nutritional analysis is combined with the in-body composition, body composition analysis. One way the team supporting with nutrition, except not only, they have a special treat too. They make rice balls and they make soup for the snack, is to calculate and support the swimmers with information how to manage nutrition in combination with the plan for competition. This is what I think will be emerging technologies, some of them. There will be many, of course. motion tracking, and I think relaying functions online, real time, will be realized in a few years for accelerometer data, or for maybe even there are waterproof EMG sensors. I think virtual reality will be a teaching aid. If I were you, I would buy a PS, the new PlayStation, and try to work around how to get the material in there, like 8K video in the PlayStation, virtual reality. Smarter phones, they're already separated into phones and cameras, I think. And waterproofing is not a problem. Higher frame rates, higher resolution. I would like to have a camera phone that could manage 60 frames still pictures. Yeah, that would be fun. Camera with onboard computer, sports camera. There is a sports camera. Casio has a sports camera with an onboard computer that can process image and has a good Wi-Fi or near field transmission. 8K, I think this is already, it's not, I don't know if it's used in sports, but there are already implantable sensors for biochemistry, blood biochemistry that can be used. Markerless motion capture, automated tracking. 2003, Bruce, they tried in Barcelona from camera out, I think. 2007 in Chiba, in Japan, Japan Open, they did. Hamamatsu Photonics had a project, and they did all swimmers, all lanes, automatically. Maybe too expensive for some organization to buy. So, this is pretty much the application of, for me, what I have to do. This is what I do many times, to try to get the data and get the data to the coaches. And also try to connect and advise directly. And I advise you to do it, or have somebody that does it. So you have a speaking partner as a coach, somebody that provokes you a little bit sometimes, or a lot sometimes, and try to get data. More data is not better, but you don't really know when you need the data. And this is what the underwater looks like. Just a simple underwater camera. Maybe a carriage is better, but the carriage is more complex. Long rod is pretty good and give you good information. This is another thing with the Japanese. This is Hamamatsu pool. This is a 50 meter pool split in 25 over here. This is lengthwise and this is across. And over here is a diving well. I would say there's pretty good information in this about tracks and trajectories. And it's exhausting to try to keep up. But good exercise. And my opinion is quite clear. It is not such a rush. If you make sure you get the data, if maybe this is Diaceto, maybe Diaceto swims in training, maybe he would hit 200 IM long course. If he has a good day, maybe he swims 157, 158, a very good day. If you miss video on that day, you don't have it. You just have you don't need to use it for immediate decisions or make choices, but you have a wider experience. Takes time. And this is Diaceto doing something completely different, but in the same spirit, I think. Technology has a long history. And can you run that? This is from 1964 Tokyo Olympics. And a legendary American swimmer. The dive is done a little bit differently. Strong kicking though. Slow-mo.
シュランダーはこの75メートル付近から一気にスパートをかけます。出足だけでラストに伸びのないいわゆるスプリンターの弱点をついて勝負に出ました。シュランダーの規則正しい6ビートは6回とも強く、レジェンド。いわゆる6ビートの強弱弱という
シュランダーの優勝は、これからのスプリンターが必ずしも泳ぐだけでなく、泳法やペースもよく研究しなければレースに勝てないことを教えています。1着シュランダーのタイムは53秒4、2着タッチの差でマクレガー53秒5です。53-4、ニューオリンピックレコード。ではシュランダーの練習中の水中のフォームを見てみましょう。アンダーウォーター、スローモー。レースの時とは違って力は入っていませんが、
基本的な6ビートの泳法はバランスもよく完璧です。東京大会はもちろんのこと、水泳史上フォームの点でシュランダーに勝る選手は見当たりません。強いて言えば日本の牧野翔造。For
the Tokyo 2020, I think this is an example of Japanese high-tech vision. The sky is the limit.
One of the many projects aiming to make it a spectacular event is something that promises to be any firework display you've ever seen. A plan to put a micro satellite into orbit that will, at the right moment, fire tiny particles into the atmosphere that will burn up and become on-demand shooting stars. This is Project Sky Canvas.
So, to finish it off, I think we should think of always adapting technology, because it plays a big role, and it will play a very important role as driver of development and of defining problems that has to do with how to support decision making for performance development. Coaches need information but also need to define the proper problems. I think that's creativity. The solution is important, but the problem must be the right one. Otherwise, there will be no changes. You look for solutions, but you haven't defined the problem. Maybe the difficult thing is defining the problem. Spend the time doing it and technology can help describe what's in it. Okay, thank you. Sayonara, see you in Tokyo.
Some question for Magnus. I will do one, Magnus. I will do one question.
Yep.
About interpretation of all these dates for young coaches. How you can manage both in Sweden and now in Japan, because you know, if you have some information, you have to interpret it to a good result.
My way, is discussing, intervening, sometimes asking, sometimes telling, sometimes provoking, I would say. So I think interpretation is in collaboration, in communication. It's not that tricky. Looking for one truth, then you get a problem. But if you open to many solutions and you approach the problem that way, for example, starts and dives. I would love to have a Kistler full video high-speed system. You used one, David, right? I would like to have it. We have a starting block and a video system. It's not turnkey. That's an example. You do the test, the swimmer does the test, they can compare. But you set up the interpretation is setting up the condition, I think.
Thank you.
So that's teaching.
Hello. Yeah, I come from India. This was fantastic. This is something 50 years ahead than what we see in India. But I would like to ask some questions like, do this analysis to be done in a particular period or it has to be done every day?
Sorry?
The analysis, video analysis has to be done every day or in a particular period?
In the GIS, the system can be turned on. If I do it, I turn on the system and then leave it. And you have the cameras running. Coaches go to the screen and watch many times. So when swimmers are doing the sets, the coaches go to the screen. And this is an interesting solution that swimmers showed me. I could have thought of it. But when we have... after the trials, most of the times we have a sit down personal session and set up some points, key points for technical improvement. And there are many swimmers, they pick up their iPhone and say, please run the movie. They start just running the phone, capturing the movie and us talking. And that's a very simple way. And swimmers go to the split screen and they do. So every day.
It's every day.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
My advice is do it often. That's how you introduced it. I think that's how you introduce thinking.
Great presentation from Argentina. I'd like to know when you perform the IST test, I mean the intensive, they swim 5 seconds, rest 10 seconds. You get a curve on the heart rate, and what is the data to the coaches, and what are they looking for the next time they come, or the swimmers?
They're looking for handling the time, more repetitions at the same speed. So that's what you can do with the flu. You can do that type of thing. Maybe you can do it with a Ben-Hur, if you like. You measure if you have like a resistive device, you can just measure the force. As long as how long can you keep the force? You can even simulate tethered if you use a force measurement device. You could actually use the force, average force drop, as the cutoff. So that would be improvement.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know about if you could do prolonged sprints and use that as a measure of the effect, maybe.
No more questions. So thank you again, Magnus, and
thank you.